Hello?
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, listen, I know you're getting married in a few hours. Congratulations. I just wanted to say... Kate, you know what you said to me the day we signed our divorce papers?
Yeah, I remember.
I want you to know that I see it now. I'm sorry it took me so long. If only I'd had a crystal ball, if I could have seen the way that this all ended up.
Yeah. Life would be much simpler if we could live it backwards.
From Providence, Rhode Island, welcome to This Is Us 2. It's a podcast dedicated to This Is Us on NBC. So sit back, relax, and let's have a good cry. Hi, everybody, and welcome. My name's Mary Larson.
My name is Blake, and that, ladies and gents, that... is how you do television.
Woof.
Man, that was something. And wow. Just excellent writing,
mm-hmm.
excellent directing, mm-hmm. The lighting, everything about editing. The editing was just phenomenal.
Yes.
You can't get any better than what we got in terms of the editing. But just what a way to frame this relationship, and I know I've said this before, and I'll say it again, and I'll die on this hill. The emotional math adds up.
Yes.
It all adds up. It all makes sense. And even though earlier in the season we were kind of looking at Toby as the villain here, he really isn't.
Neither of them are.
They just aren't suited at this point. And what Kate says is just so relevant to their relationship. I'm just huge on this episode. Massive on this episode. Do you have a story would you like me to share a story? Because I do have a fun story.
It says story, Blake, so I didn't prepare one.
Okay, well, I have one. And it's not necessarily how I relate to this episode, but I want to give you the context under which I watched this episode.
Okay.
I watched this episode. I was away from Mary because I was out on a business trip, ironically enough, in Florida. And, you know, like, because I was on a business trip in Florida, we obviously didn't get a chance to podcast about it this week. So again, thank you very much for your patience, because then the following week, Mary and I went on vacation. So now, whatever, it is what it is. I was in the airport, and I was in the airport all day, like literally from, I don't know, maybe 12 in the afternoon all the way till 9 o'clock at night. And I did a ton of work, but Mary's like, hey, you should watch This Is Us because
you got time to kill.
You got time to kill. And we're going to podcast about it when you come home, which we didn't, but that's fine because we were busy. And so I want you to watch it. I said, okay, yeah, I'll watch it. So I'm in the Fort Lauderdale airport. And for those of you who have been there, to good old FLL, you know that is a massive freaking airport. And I get there, and I'm sitting down, and I'm doing work, and I'm like, hey, I'll watch This Is Us now. I put it in, and immediately start crying.
In an airport.
In an airport in front of thousands of people. Thousands. Just walking by me, and I'm holding back my tears as hard as I can. And, like, you know that moment when you hold tears back, like, so hard that it hurts? Like, it hurts your throat, and it hurts, like, that. You know that back part of your throat?
I don't, because I either don't cry that often, or I just let it happen, man.
Oh.
I'm a believer. You got to let those feelings show.
The problem is I'm a Pisces, so if I cried every single time that I wanted to cry.
Yeah, you would.
I wouldn't stop crying.
You would be dry.
I would be, like... I would be like sadness
Inside Out.
That would be me. That or I'd be like the sand people in Star Wars, just because I'm so dry. So yeah, that's what happened to me. And what an experience holding back all of those tears in front of all of those people, trying to look normal and like.
When really nobody cares. Nobody cares.
Nobody's looking at me.
Like running around.
But I'm the idiot that's like, oh, everybody's staring at me because I'm crying.
Because I'm watching Katoby.
I know. And dude, instantly started crying. Just I'm not even kidding. That first scene, I cried.
Because, yeah, the one that you played?
Yeah. Just how it was shot, how it was edited, the whole, all of it. Oh, man, what a disaster I was. Yeah. So for that day. So that is how I related to.
But you got to watch it. And you felt your feelings.
I felt all. Every single feeling there ever has been in humanity, I felt at that moment.
Nice. Well, before we get into the rest of this episode, we want to remind you all to check on out all of our socials. You can find us on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube just by searching Marianne Blake. We also have a ton of other podcasts. You can find those at marianneblake.com. And we would love to invite you to our exclusive Facebook group. All you need to do is go to Facebook and search Mary and Blake. There we get to talk about all of these shows and more. You're going to find a great community there. So on that note, let's get into the show.
All right, Marvin, this episode was entitled Katoby, as we all know, it is the shipping name, if you will, of Kate and Toby, mm-hmm. and such a great shipping name. I right from the jump, I loved that ship name.
Agreed.
Such a great name. And this was directed and written by, I would dare say, This Is Us royalty, because it's directed by Ken Olin and written by Isaac Aptaker and Elizabeth Berger. Now, you actually have not heard their name this season yet.
I'm like, I know their names.
Yes. Well, because they were the co-showrunners for a few seasons. And it's not to say that Dan Fogelman wasn't running the show because he created it, but mm-hmm. it was like Isaac Aptaker and Elizabeth Berger kind of like took the reins from him mm-hmm. for a little bit there while he was doing his other movies and yada yada. It feels like he is reassumed the lead showrunner role, because Isaac Aptaker and Elizabeth Berger have actually created their own show in the meantime during the COVID break.
What did they create?
They created How I Met Your Father, which is like the spinoff series of How I Met Your Mother.
Okay.
And apparently it's been getting very good reviews. And it's also one of the other, one of the many shows that they've been writing on. They've also written, that show Love, Simon mm-hmm. on Netflix. Or is it Hulu? I can't remember. It's one or the other.
I don't even know what it is.
But yeah, you haven't heard their names this season a whole ton, because this is the first episode they've written for this season. And when you look back and you see all the different episodes that they have written, you kind of get why they're This Is Us royalty and why they were brought up to co-showrunners.
Nice.
So like,
okay, yeah.
You have Pilgrim Rick, Jack Pearson's son,
yep.
Moonshadow, Deja Vu, The Car, The Wedding, 9 Bucks, Her, The Pool Part 2, The Cabin, There,
oh, yeah.
and Jerry 2.0. Like, those are heavy hitters when it comes to This Is Us. I would say that the earlier episodes are more heavy hitters than the later ones. Nevertheless, excellent stuff.
Agreed.
And Ken Olin, he's directed a kabillion episodes of This Is Us. He's the primary director. And if you want to listen to all the ones or see all the episodes that he's directed, do that in your own time. Just mm-hmm. go to imdb.com. You can get that information there. Lemonade ratings, Marvin. What do you got for this episode?
It's a big old 5, yep. almost a 5+.
Ooh. What holds it from being a 5+?
There was no Jack Pearson. And there was no place for Jack Pearson, aside from the mention of Jack Pearson.
Yeah.
And there's no way he could have fit in, but...
But part of me likes the fact that he's not in it.
I know. But because, that's why, like, I'm saying it's a 5. It's a 5.
Yes.
Like, still super duper solid. I did not cry.
You didn't cry?
No.
Oh my God. I sobbed all the tears.
I wonder. if children, if fellow children of divorce,
you're a wizard, Harry.
Because we're like, yep. Whereas, because so my parents are divorced.
Yes.
Blake's parents didn't divorce. Like, I wonder if, I don't know, or maybe they would cry just as much and I'm just insensitive. Plus, we all knew it was going to happen.
Yeah, it's...
I think what's weird, too, is... yeah, I didn't cry.
Like, there's...
I felt lots of feelings. I'm not a stone.
Sure.
But I didn't cry.
Well, you know what? Let's move on to... We'll move on to the yes. to the GBGs in my lemonade rating, and then we'll talk about all this stuff, okay? My lemonade rating, I'm giving this a 4.999, okay? We're getting deep into the thousandths, okay?
Okay.
I can't give it a 5. I can't. I really want to. Like, part of me really wants to give it a 5.
Okay.
But part of me also knows that I'm a hot ass, so I want to save that 5 rating for later on, knowing that this episode, how much I loved it, but there are two things that prevent me from giving a full 5, and they're little ticky-tack things, and I know it's going to piss people off.
Okay.
But I got to do it. I'm take this, bunkered.
We're used to you, Blake. We're used to you.
What do you get for your GBG?
Okay. So my good karaoke. Karaoke and tub thumping.
Oh, out on
talking
karaoke.
About Backstreet Boys. I mean, once again, Target demo nailed. My karaoke song was not tub thumping. Is I just find that the same note all of the time. Not really fun. Down. I mean, great for like poignancy to what they were getting. But as two musicians.
But you're never going to keep me down.
I would have hoped that they would have chosen.
I get knocked down.
More songs.
But yeah, I don't
get. Okay, we're done, Blake. We're done. My karaoke jam, once again. I have two of them. First one is the Thong Song by Cisco.
Yes.
That's love your, that. And it has a bit more of a melodic fun to it. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then my other favorite one. Is Mbop. Both of those songs make people go, what in the freaking world is going on?
Yeah, Mbop is one. I thought you would go with more of a Proud Mary.
No, that's my Drunk in a Bar song.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Fair enough.
No, I don't, because I don't want to do like actual songs that people
know and like
expect.
Care about. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because nobody cares about Mbop.
Nobody cares how you sing in karaoke, okay? They're just there for a good time.
Nobody should care about karaoke at all because it sucks.
I love karaoke. Blake hates karaoke. Sucks. I haven't been able to do enough karaoke since I've been with Blake because he doesn't enjoy it. I have a blast, but that's it. We go, I think too, because I'm a musician, and this is how I took it also, like, okay, Kate and Patrick, Philip, I'm naming him the wrong thing. Oh. Kate and Philip, who am I? Who am I, Rebecca?
Yeah.
The more I think about it, maybe that's why they chose Tub Thumping, because you know she's singing normal songs all the time and he's playing normal songs all the time. So go and have fun. In my dream world, they went from Tub Thumping to Mbop, then the Thong Song, and then Wild Wild West. Wicked Wild Wild West. Okay, my bad.
Yeah.
Oysters.
What do you
oysters
mean?
At the engagement party.
Oh yeah.
I'm allergic to oysters, so that's like my like. Bad, but my bad, how bad I felt when Philip's blind wife who couldn't conceive babies gets killed by a drunk driver,
smushed by a car. Did not see that coming. Did
no,
like you knew that they were gonna have something special in store for us just because of how much of like a jabroni he is or he was at first.
No, he's just British.
Very British. So very, very British.
Oh my gosh. But This Is Us was like, okay, let's have them have difficulties because of infertility. Yes. You know, that's been a storyline for us. You know what fit is if she was blind because he works at a blind school.
They had like a bingo box.
Okay, so how are they gonna get divorced? Is she gonna cheat on him? No, let's have her die. Okay, so how is she gonna die? I don't know.
What if she got hit by a bus? I don't know. That's a great idea.
In an Uber.
Oh,
killed by a drunk driver.
Man, just did not see that coming.
Nope.
Wow.
I'm just looking for happiness. Oh, Philip, you took me. And then my great is that divorce is shown on TV without it being a soap opera. Like, I feel like divorce isn't a frequent thing on TV, particularly with kids. Like, people might get divorced on TV and then end up back together. And then in soap operas, they get divorced, but then they, like, sleep with their brother and their cousin. And then they get back together 50 million times. And then, you know, they have a mutant baby. I don't know. It's just not realistic. Whereas this felt realistic. And I've said it before and I'll say it again. This Is Us takes difficult things that we experience in our real life and portrays them very well on television.
Yes, I would absolutely agree with you on that one. All right, my good. It's a Mary and Blake Media commandment. Mm-hmm. Bookends.
Oh, your faves.
Give me all the freaking bookends. And not only did we get one bookend, we got two bookends. We get the bookend of
Toby's phone call
and having that recontextualized through the lens that he would never understand, but mm-hmm. then he does admit that he understands.
Yes.
And hearing that conversation and what it was at that point, and then having Toby be able to recognize that Kate wasn't necessarily right, but sees her point.
Yeah.
And like, I get it now. Mm-hmm. Like there's still room there for him to be like, I don't agree. Like, this sucks, but I get it. Yeah. I see it. And then also there is a fantastic bookend with little Jack and adult Jack when he's like, you're both here.
Oh.
Like, oh man. Jack, oh man.
Jack pulls at my heartstrings.
That kid, first of all, that kid actor.
The little one?
The little one. Oh, forget about
it. Baby Jack.
Baby Jack.
Boba Fett's in the toilet. You both have to stop fighting.
Oh man. Like, that kid is equally heartbreaking and heartwarming at the same time. Like, the fact that he knew to take his Boba Fett and throw it in the toilet, like, just for them to stop fight. Jack. The way that it's written, oh!
Baby Jack.
And it acted, oh! Oh! That kid.
At least he stopped running away.
Take away the red boots.
Yeah.
The bad. All right, now, here are my two little dinky-doink bads. Okay? These bads prevent it from being a full out five.
Okay. Because mine didn't prevent it from being a 5+. I'm just saying what made me feel bad.
Yeah, no,
but
I like to nitpick. Listen, when we're getting into these
five ranges, you got to nitpick. Yes.
We just can't be throwing out fives like we're Oprah. Okay? Yeah, we can't be just tossing them about.
Okay. What's your nitpick?
Listen, do I buy the relationship between Philip and Kate?
I do.
Yes, absolutely. I absolutely understand where he's coming from based off of his bingo box of awfulness. Oh,
this is a Charmin box winner.
And I also buy Kate, you know, going into his arms a little bit and appreciating each other for where they are, when they are, and how they are. Mm-hmm. I get all of it. However, big however, we don't see a moment between the two that gets us from we're co-workers to let's go on a date.
Oh, we don't get him asking her out on a date?
We don't get anything. It's just, okay, they're dating now because they're going on a date because the plot needs them to go on a date.
Wasn't it when he asks her to go to karaoke? I took that.
No. Their first date.
Their first date was the mariachi band.
Yes.
But then I thought that the first like pseudo pre-date was karaoke, him asking her because he knew she needed to be cheered up. And I would have taken that as.
I guess.
Hey, this was fun. How about we get dinner next week? Like, you wanted that moment. Let's get dinner. And her go, oh my gosh. Okay.
Yeah. And she does have that freak out moment at the dinner, right? Like,
yeah.
there is that, like,
okay, I didn't need it, but I could appreciate that you wanted it. But that's how I saw the timeline.
Yeah, sure. And that makes sense.
Tub thumping.
Yeah, but like, even then,
margaritas. Okay,
but even then, why is he inviting her out? Like,
because he's your coworker and they've been now working. So that happens 16 months later.
Yeah, but like, that's pretty heavy, though.
No, that's not.
That's pretty heavy.
They're both single and she's been going for 16 months to therapy. And this is a really hard thing. And they're working much more closely together now with her new job. So
fair enough.
Let's just take it that over a year and a half, they became even closer friends.
Fair enough. And then the other ticky-tack bad that I got is Toby calling on the wedding day.
Ugh.
Listen, loved the moment. Loved it. Not the right time, Toby. Not the right time. We don't go calling on wedding days.
We don't need your blessing, Toby.
Yeah. Day before? Sure. Day after? Okay. Not day of.
Send a card.
And that, to me, feels more writerly than it needed to be.
I would disagree. I think that Toby is a theatrical man.
Good, you know what? A valid point. Valid point. But Toby also, to me, if he's that sensitive in nature now to her point, he would understand that that's probably not the most opportune time to make that phone call.
Whatevs.
Whatevs. And my great. The great for me is two things, really. First, it's just the structure of the episode, how it forces you to stay with it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it goes from one timeline to the next, and then it goes in between those two timelines, and then it goes forward even more. And then, like, you are forced to keep up with the show. The show does not make excuses for you. And that works on many different levels, because you get the sense that it's all happening, like, at a very quick pace. And what they're trying to elicit, I think, is that life is freaking messy. And the timeline and the structure and the narrative structure of this episode is also messy, but in a delightful way. It purposely puts you on your toes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that it allows itself some it allows itself enough disorientation for you as the viewer, where you're like, okay, whoa. And it allows you to accept the larger plot points much easier because of this disorientation, right? Like, Madison all of a sudden is pregnant, and you know, we got the wedding, and then the stuff with Rebecca's memory is moving very fast. Like, she can't remember Philip's name for a little bit. And, like, there's a lot of stuff going on.
The look that they all give her when she does remember Philip, it was like sticker. It was like you were just given a sticker.
Yes.
Good job, Rebecca. You still got it.
And then, like, the big point of this, too, is the fact that their divorce does happen. And the relationship between Kate and Philip does happen. So, like, all of these things are moving all at once, and it allows you not just like a paint by numbers, okay, we're doing X, Y, and Z. It's like, no. We're doing all of this, and we're going to throw it at you.
Mm-hmm.
I really like that, the narrative choice that they made. But the big one, Marvin.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness gracious. Like, I don't know how... Okay, here it is.
I mean, how could it not be this?
If there is any doubt left, if there's any doubt left that these writers listen to this podcast, I'll eat my hat. I'm wearing my tattered old Red Sox hat that I've had for years now. It's all,
you know,
sweaty
what I
and
need?
Gross. I will eat my hat.
If there is someone out there, maybe after the show is done, they
yeah, just
send,
like,
us an
send
email
a, send
or
us a
message
or
being like, it was me.
Yeah, like, I love the fact that you guys played Whitney. So we totally did that. And, like, the fun thing is, too, not only was it funny, but it was just great to see the two of them laugh. Like, and laugh like they used to laugh.
Mm-hmm.
And then also have that moment of like, okay, see you later. Like, gotta go.
I loved it.
I loved that
it.
Moment.
Yeah.
It worked on so many different levels. And it is a guarantee that these writers listen to This Is Us Too. There's just no way. Like, come on, man. There's just too many coincidences now. Get out of here with all that. All right. You got anything else for your GBGs?
That is it.
All right. So listen, listeners. Normally, this episode would have a structure that you're used to, which is the big three feedback, and then we, Mary and I, talk about stuff, and then we do the in or out. However, because we got so many voicemails,
and y'all had a lot to say,
we're going to play all of them. And Mary and I are just, we're gonna play them, we're going to talk, and then we're just going to discuss. And we're going to forego the in or out portion of this episode, which sucks because it's my favorite segment in all of Mary and Blake Media. But I just find it more important that all of you have the platform to speak. And I said this during the Jack Mother episode. Mm-hmm. You can tell when this episode is special based upon the how much feedback we get.
Oh, I dig that.
And we got a lot during Jack's Mother episode, and then we got a lot during this episode. Mm-hmm. So I just want to play the stuff, and we'll just go through it, and we'll forego the in or out, and then we'll move on from there. Is that fair?
Yeah.
All right. So, but before we do the voicemails, I want to say, and I want to kind of go back, Mary, to what you were saying about Jack. Mm-hmm. How you wished he was in the episode. Part of me...
I mean, I don't really wish it. I'm just saying, for things to be a plus.
Yeah, if it needs to be a plus, you would have had to have Jack Pearson. Part of me...
He's still there.
...likes the fact that he's mentioned but not shown. Because Jack Pearson to Kate Pearson at this moment, or Kate Damon, is a myth. And for Toby to not only call upon that myth, but put it into question, big no-no. Big no-no. And I wanted to get your thought on that. Like, do you find it better that he's not in now that we have that framing?
Yeah.
Or is it...
It wouldn't have fit at all in this episode. He couldn't be in it. Yeah. So I loved how they put it in there. And it made me... I've never heard Kate compare him to Jack, so it was kind of out of the blue. But I appreciate bringing him back because you're right. Kate always did kind of idolize her dad.
And part of that, too, I cried at that moment because, you know, we're it's meant to elicit, you know, a response, which is fine. But that, to me, again, the emotional math adds up. That feels like the moment Kate would say, yeah, we can't do this. Because her dad is just this, you know, godlike figure in her mind. And to even dress down any of that in any nature, ooh, bad. But I also cried because I kind of get it. And not that I face any of necessarily that understanding from you, Mary. Like you're not comparing me to your dad or whatever.
No, I compare you to Jack Pearson.
That's true.
Yes, we have a saying in this house.
Yeah, what would Jack Pearson do?
Yeah,
that is 100% true. That is 100% true. Whenever I'm going full Pisces, Mary says, what would Jack Pearson do?
Yes.
That's
how I got Blake to coach soccer.
That is also very true for a sport that I have no knowledge of whatsoever, yet I'm coaching it. It's okay. I get it because of the other way around. My mother died, and it's not that I compare you, Mary, to my mother.
Oh, good.
But I see it. Like, if you were to say to me, I'm not Noreen Larson, I'd be like, hey, like, so, like, I get it on both sides.
Okay.
Because I get that frustration that Toby has.
Yes.
But I also see the, like, that pushback of, No. We don't
go there.
We don't talk about...
We're done. We don't talk about Bruno.
Yeah, we don't talk about Bruno, yeah. So I just wanted to say that. I think it was a valid thing. And
I agree.
I just think that was a really good part of the episode. All right, you ready to get to some voicemails?
Yes.
All right, so we're going to do more than the big three, but I'm still going to play the sound nevertheless.
And we said...
That's three.
Big three?
Big three!
All right, here we go.
Hi, Mary and Blake. This is Faye calling from Norway.
Hi, Faye.
I have a question for Blake about lighting. And this is a bit of a general question, but I thought of it while watching This Is Us season 6, episode 10, Every Version of You. And the question is regarding how, like, lighting in terms of how to light people of color or black people specifically. In this episode, I mean, I thought about this in many cases, but this episode, I think, is a good example of how bad lighting can be for people with dark skin. Mm-hmm. There's a scene in this episode where Kate and Toby are fighting outside and it's nighttime, so of course it's dark. And then Kevin and Randall join in. And then there's a shot where we're seeing them profile with the house on the background, and we clearly see Toby, and then on the other side of the shot we see Kate and Kevin, and we know Randall is there, but you can't really see him because he's standing kind of in the negative space between the windows, and he's black and you can't see him because it's so dark. And it just frustrates me because I don't know, there must be a way to light this that isn't shining a beam on them that mm-hmm. still makes it natural, like it's nighttime, but it must be a way to light people of color properly, right? So yeah, it's a nerd question, tech question for you, Blake. Love you guys.
Yeah, so that's a great that's a really great question. So here's what I'll say. When lighting a darker skin tone is very hard because you have the natural lightness of it's the surroundings, right? And you, especially when a lighter skinned tone is combined with a darker skin tone. What I think in years past, up until fairly recently, filmmaking just treated it as though it's a specific one shot, one size fits all light, because, you know, lighter skin tone accepts light differently than a darker skin tone. And some light balances off darker skin tones more vibrantly than lighter skin tones. And what you saw was kind of like a bleaching effect overall. Mm. And the way that I would say this is what I think filmmakers have learned is that lighting for darker skin tones isn't about washing out anymore. It's not about bringing everything to the same level. It's about how to sculpt that skin tone to give it its most natural feel. Mm. So I think in large part, what you'll find is that you'll find a lot of different color filters on lights and how it's bounced off. In large part, you'll see a lot of cinematographers use these big, big white sheets to bounce light off of their subjects even more, like off to the left or to the right of them. Mm-hmm. And in some cases, for lighter skin tones, there are instances where cinematographers use big black sheets so that the light gets soaked up into the blackness of the sheet. So there are a bunch of different ways to create all different kind of lighting effects. And then I think also, too, a lot of the differences you're finding are just in color grading in post-production. I think people are just more aware of how to make darker skin tones more natural looking now.
Yeah, you know, I'm rewatching the scene in question. Of course, this is from the Saturday in the Park scene. And what I will also say is I think Randall was supposed to be in the background as a character a bit more until he steps forward. Both he and Kevin are wearing really dark clothes in that scene, whereas Kate and Toby are wearing light clothes. So not only do they have the lighter skin, but just you're supposed to have the focal, the focus on the two of them. And then Kevin is the one that starts to speak up first. So he steps in front. So you can't see Randall in some of the shots because it's Kevin who's speaking up. And then when Randall does step forward, they use almost this blue light on him, particularly to shine on his glasses and then kind of on his forehead area. And what I love about this, you know, he also gets picked up from the house light. But I noticed even in I think it was this episode that when he's outside It's sorry, I'm forgetting exactly which episode it is, but he's outside with Kate and with Kevin, and I think it is Saturday in the Park because I think they're drinking, and he has that blue light shining off of his forehead.
Yeah, yeah.
So it really kind of gives that definition because they're out in the backyard and it is very dark, so they're able to still do that. And I will say that. You know, the light, the crew obviously on This Is Us is a diverse crew. So yeah. They are very aware of that. And I think in particular in that, at that scene, I think that Randall was the least speaking character. Mm-hmm. I think it really was, you know, obviously when he steps forward, he pops a little bit more in the light, but that's what I've noticed is the blue light, on his deep skin tone really, helps him shine as a character.
Yeah.
Without making it super obvious what they're trying to do.
And another thing too, like it gives it a more cinematic feel, which is again how we talked about, you know, color grading, but also filters, different colors. Mary, you talked about blue lights, there are orange lights, and it's not necessarily about, again, washing out directly a person's face or their skin tone. It's about having that light reflect off of something. Mm-hmm. And then having the skin reflect the light that's coming off from a different direction. That allows for a more sculpting, more natural looking face. Mm-hmm. And that's just how it is. Don't blast somebody with the light. Let the skin tone reflect the light. Mm-hmm. Which I like. All right, you ready for the next voicemail?
Yes.
Let's do it. If my computer will let me. Okay, here, let's redo that, Blake.
Hi, Mary. Hi, Blake. Hi, Nerd Clan. This is Rachel, longtime listener, first-time caller, and huge fan.
Rachel.
My lemonade rating for tonight's episode. This was such an amazing episode. While I expected the 100th episode to be something that was more circled around the main Pearsons, for a 100th episode, this was still pretty damn phenomenal. Mm-hmm. And for that reason alone, I give this episode a score of 4.987 lemonades. We're talking down to the hundreds here. My good, I've always had a hard time seeing the similarities between the different ages of Kate, and I finally saw the late teens Kate in Chrissy Metz when she was sitting outside of the restaurant on her first date with Philip.
Good, yeah.
Looked identical. My bad, Sophie, no tea, no shade, no pink lemonade to her, but I've always been way out on her ending up with Kevin. I do have a hot take on this, and I'll have to get to it in a second message. It just crushed me so hard to see Madison being all happily married and pregnant and realizing that the door is officially closed on Kevin and Madison being together, because it seems like it's opening up for Sophie. Am I great? I really enjoyed the bouncing timeline and the book ending in this episode. We saw the chain of events take us chain link by chain link, both forward and backward of Katoby. We saw the few hours before the wedding, then the morning after the lawn argument, then went forward a bit and back a bit, and the book ending with little Jack saying, "You're both here." And then him saying it in the far future was so cute and sweet, like a little inside joke / family quote thing. Loved it.
Oh, Rachel.
Yes, yes,
Rachel,
yes.
I'm just going to play this.
Bam! Just like that. A winner!
Excellent, excellent, excellent. But you know what? We're going to get to a hot take because it's right here. I can see it. So let's just play it.
Hi, Rachel again here. This is my hot take that I said I would get to in a second message.
All right.
My hot take.
Oh, hold on. You know what we got to do? We got to do this.
As much as I hate to say it, my hot take is that the time frame between Kate's and Philip's engagement party to their wedding day, I predict Sophie's husband is going to die and Kevin will end up with Sophie. Plus, she is also a nurse, and based on the previews for next week, it looks like we may need her nurse skills for Rebecca. Plus, it was mentioned that the Pearson Pavilion that Kevin is building should have a home for the nurse to stay at, and I imagine that nurse will end up being Sophie.
Oh my God.
So anyways, that's all from me today. I just thank you guys so much for listening and hopefully playing this message on the podcast. And thank you so much for being our Lumos in a time of Knox.
Oh, thank you, Rachel.
Rachel, you get this.
Makes me wanna shout.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. Well, I love Sophie the sleuth work that you've done here with the nurse and all that stuff. How do you feel, Mary, about Kevin ending up with Sophie?
Marriage.
Marriage.
I'm okay with it. I'm a sucker for the Sophie angle. I'm okay with it.
I will say that
I don't want her husband to die tragically, but I mean, this is us, right? If you're gonna die, it better make people cry.
Yeah. You know, we went back, you know, in time to think, like, Sophie and the husband, when they were getting engaged, were having issues, if you remember that correctly.
Yes.
So part of me wonders, did Sophie get married to the guy hoping that it would fix the thing, and maybe it doesn't fix the thing, and that's what ends up happening when she sees Kevin and, you know, all the stuff that's happening with his mother and, you know, all of it all together. Is that what leads to them maybe getting back together again?
I don't know.
It feels like it's going that direction.
I love that. Well done, Rachel.
Yeah, very, very good. All right, let's do the next one.
Hi, Mary and Blake. This is Ethan from Phoenix, calling in about the latest episode of This Is Us.
Hi, Ethan.
I'm giving it a 5.
Yes.
I loved every second of it. So for my ratings and everything, like I said, I'm giving it a 5. So with my good, just the way that they depicted, you know, their marriage kind of falling apart. Mm-hmm. I know it sounds weird to say that it was good, but, just authentic. Everything about that just felt authentic to me.
Oh, look at that.
Better, selling me on Kate and Philip. I thought that they did a great job of really, you know, making that feel okay. Even though, you know, we've been with, Kate and Toby for so long, this now feels good. All right. And then my great, that last montage of them, you know, going to Jack's show and mm-hmm. then circling it back to the beginning conversation with Kate and Toby on Kate's wedding day was just phenomenal. Hope you guys all liked it too. Bye.
Yeah, Ethan, got to tell you, that final montage of all of them together, seeing Jack, and even wrapping up the fact that Toby is once again married to this new person.
Coffee girl.
And I even buy that too, like the with their little interaction that they have over the yogurt.
Mm-hmm.
I buy it. I don't know why I buy it. I don't think I would normally buy it in any other situation.
Because I think they had zingers. I think both he and Kate had those little touch zingers.
Yes, and part of me thinks like I buy it because I just want Toby to be happy. So like, oh yeah, you found somebody that makes a yogurt joke just like you. Like yay, wee. But I like it.
Me too.
And again, it just, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I also think too, after you've gone through divorce or, you know, just being older in life and going through different relationships or having even losses in your life, you just look at life a bit differently and relationships a bit differently. Yeah. Many people say, you know, that in their second marriage, they realize things that they would have done differently in their first. Yeah. You know, maybe I wouldn't have nitpicked XYZ. Maybe I would have tried to be a bit more compassionate about this other thing. So I think that it does make sense for you to find somebody and to say, this works.
Yeah.
And maybe 10 years, 20 years ago, me would have thought this person wasn't right. But now I've actually learned a lot of lessons.
Yeah, we know that's very true for you and I, because 10, 15 years ago, oh no, actually, sorry, 20 years ago.
We were together then, yeah.
20 years ago, you would not have wanted to be with me.
Correct.
But for some reason, maybe it was all the Guinness, somehow I convinced
you. You wouldn't have been with me either.
I know.
You tell me all the time, you're like, I would have made fun of you.
I would have ranked on you. I would have dragged you through, oh, yeah, I would have totally... Totally
I wouldn't have even seen you because you were just indoors playing video games.
That's true. Drinking beers, playing Madden.
Yeah.
The other thing I want to say, too, is like I also think that the show does a really smart thing with Toby in that it takes him from one extreme to the other, where it goes, we have the emotional roller coaster of him being like, okay, I'll do whatever it takes. I don't care. Mm-hmm. He takes the job that sucks. He goes to the therapy. Kate shows up late. He's pissed off. And then he's like, fine, whatever. If you come in late, I'm leaving early. But then we also travel back to him saying, we can't do this. This can't be the end of our story. He tries to kiss her. And like, it's just this emotional roller coaster that Toby has. So that when you do finally see that moment when he sees Yogurt Girl, you're like, okay, I just want him to be happy. Like, yeah. I just want him. You're feeling the finality of what is coming, right? And I think they're sprinkling in that finality very well, in so much that you know that it's the final season. But it's not like, okay, now this person gets their send-off and that person gets their send-off. It's being sprinkled in through large plot points that the show is trying to command. My one question to you, Mary, is Ethan said that he felt good about the Kate and Philip relationship. I do too. Mm-hmm. But does the show cheat a little bit? Like we talked about, is there the moment where like, oh, hey, let's go on a date. Is there that moment? Fine. We talked about that. But does the show cheat? Because it automatically shows you their first kiss pretty quickly. And it shows them being like in love and, oh, I'm gonna propose. And does it earn that?
No, I think it earns it.
Yeah.
We've known Philip for quite some time. And I particularly loved watching him play Go Fish with Jack-Jack, knowing that he and Haley had those posters to help on out. So that, to me, shows extreme depth in his relationship and the whole family. I loved it.
All right, let's do the next voicemail.
Good morning, Mary and Blake. This is April calling from Richmond, Virginia.
Hi, April.
I just wanted to call and comment on the Katoby episode of This Is Us 2. This Is Us. It was a great episode. I give it a 4.5 stars. I can't say I loved it because it was really hard to watch. I have to say I really felt for Toby in this episode. Yep. I give him all the credit for trying or attempting to make his marriage work, for taking a job that he hated, obviously, and relocating to put his family first. And it just... to see him in all the flashbacks, you could tell he was just miserable. He wasn't happy. Kate was fulfilled in her job and her role as a mother, and to see Toby kind of suffer through this and not feel fulfilled in any of his jobs as a father or in his job was hard to watch. I give them props for going to marriage counseling, mm-hmm. And trying to make that work also, but obviously what they did didn't work. And I also feel for Toby, it's just sad to see them. They went through so much as a couple and supported each other, through Toby's bout with depression and other things that they had going on as a couple. And ultimately to see having a child with a disability, break them. Mm-hmm. And
it looks like we got cut off. Hold on. I think this might be the next one.
Hey, it's April again. Yep. I got cut off, to see, Toby and Kate get broken by having a child with a disability. As a parent and in a marriage, when you have kids, it just completely changes your relationship and you have to be on the same page of how you parent. And obviously Toby and Kate really struggled with that, and Toby feeling criticized for everything he did, through Kate's eyes. Don't know if that's actually how it was, but I do have to say in a couple scenes that she did seem critical, though, you know, she did spend the most time with the kids. But anyway, they obviously made the right choice because it was good in the end to see them happy in their future relationships with each other, with their newfound loves. I was worried we weren't going to have enough time to see Kate and Philip together, but seeing him in this episode made me warm up to him and like him and appreciate him. And seeing Toby finally find himself and become happy in the situation that he was.
Yeah.
And I totally understand with him being scared about being alone and having to start over, but obviously it was better for him in the end because he ended up being happy, which is the best thing for them. So really good episode. Again, hard to watch, but I did enjoy it.
April, thank you so much. You bring up a great point, especially about Toby saying, I can't do this. I can't be alone. I don't want to start all over again. So let's take that and break that down for a second.
Bring it.
Toby says, we can't do this. I can't be alone, yada, yada. We have to be together. Mm-hmm. Why is he saying they have to be together? Because he can't be alone. He can't start over. It's not Kate because I love you, Kate because we're made for each other, Kate because, you know, we're destined, you know, through the stars to be together. It's I can't do this. Mm-hmm. It is a selfish reasoning. And you can feel that urgency from him. Like, it's gilded in, hey, look at us. We're great parents now. We have co-parenting skills. But it's not that.
No.
It's just insecurity. And I wanted to get your thoughts on that, Mary, if you thought that was nice.
I did, because I feel like a lot of people have that fear. You know, it's so unknown. And those who do go through this, go through divorce and co-parenting and all this kind of stuff, you know, they can share advice with friends who are beginning that journey.
Yeah.
But aside from that, it's not necessarily something people talk a lot about, because it is so hard.
Yeah.
And it can be very wretched about the other person. You know, like just like people don't talk about infertility or miscarriages and stuff a lot. But at least that you don't, hopefully you don't feel like is your fault.
Yeah.
Whereas breakups and divorces, it's hard not to have strong feelings about your ex-partner. And so for him to say, I can't go through this, because it's unknown and it's scary. And how is this going to affect our kids? And then to add the layer of, I have to date again.
Oh, no way, man. No chance. I'd be celibate. That'd be the end. I would just say, screw it. I ain't going to be with anybody else. I don't know. I don't think I could do it. I know I couldn't do it. Just, it'd be misery. That's why we're never going to get divorced, Mary.
There you go.
You're always going to be stuck with me for the rest of your life.
Just like a leech.
Just going to suck the blood right out of you. I'm going to suck the life right out of you.
Hey, there's not much left.
Yeah.
I'm running on fumes right now.
You know, Mary, I think an underappreciated scene in this episode is the football scene between Jack
and
between
Phillip.
Toby and Phillip. That scene is a remarkable scene.
Loved it so much.
And it works because Toby seemingly gives his blessing to the whole thing. But it not even necessarily that, you know, Phillip needed it, but I think we as viewers had to understand Toby's journey. And part of that journey was, okay, if this is going to happen, like, you need to do X, Y, and Z things for my kids. And I'm sure that's pretty rich coming from me, mm-hmm. because I'm sure that Kate told you all this stuff. And this is why it works. Because Phillip says to him, well, no, I didn't hear all the bad stuff. In fact, all she had to say was great things about you.
But we heard bad stuff, and we as viewers needed it, because we just came from, you know, at the birthday party where Kate was talking about Backstreet Boys, and he's like, yeah, wish it actually paid though. And that's in front of the whole family. And then the scene right before Toby and Phillip meeting is with Toby saying, I look miserable because you are in the room.
Oh man, brutal. Brutal.
And then Boba Fett in the toilet, because they were yelling so much. So we go from that scene to Guinness.
Yes.
Which he doesn't even like Guinness.
And such a great moment. Such a great moment. He's like, yeah, no, I don't like that at all, but it's fine.
So I think that was, you know, we just went through some really rough patches. Seeing it a little bit more through Kate or Jack's eyes, you know, that Kate didn't say mean things at that moment to Toby. So I liked that we were able to have this nice thing where he teaches him a bit about American football and says this is really important to her family.
Like, and you better understand this, because if you don't, you're going to have problems. And not only that, it's also part of Toby's journey to getting to the point of, I get it.
Yeah.
Right. He has enough space where he can zoom out and say, yeah, I wasn't good enough.
And next we see him getting his own apartment. And I feel like that is such a normal thing that also doesn't get talked about.
Yeah.
When traditionally the dads move out and they get the divorcee apartment.
Yep.
My dad had it. You know, my friend's ex-husband had it. Yep. You know, it's just what they do in the interim, and they have to make sure, can I take care of the kids? And is there a spot for them? My brother had it. Like, they go through this, and it generally is just a boring beige apartment.
Yeah, right.
That kind of has this rotation of divorcees.
Yeah, right.
Divorcees? How do you even say that?
Whatevs. I don't know. Stats of the nerds. And, and, like, there's another great subtle moment of him taking down the Young Frankenstein poster and just carrying it out. Like, such a great moment to symbolize the destruction of this marriage. I really like that. All right, let's do the next one.
Hi, Mary and Blake. This is Jody calling from Ohio.
Hey, Jody.
And I am calling about episode 12, Katoby. I wanted to let you guys know that I've been listening to you guys since you started This Is Us 2.
Oh.
I'm really going to miss it once this series wraps up. However, you guys haven't inspired me to watch Outlander, so I will be catching up with you guys when I start that.
All right.
This episode, I give it a 5 lemonade rating. My good is the co-parenting. I really admire them for being dedicated to having a good co-parenting relationship for the kids. It's really, really important. You know, and I love how Kate said their story doesn't end, because she's right. It doesn't. My bad is when Toby was begging Kate to work things out, he never said to her, I can't live without you. He just said, I don't want to be alone.
There
you
go. Jody just brought it up.
I know that the show is sort of designed to have you like the Pearsons, but I do see both sides of it. I feel that Toby was resentful for moving back to L.A. It was causing him to be irritable, sarcastic, and I kind of felt like he didn't want to try. And I'm probably going to have to do a part 2. Sorry, I'm trying to go fast.
It's okay, Jody. You just broke all the rules. It's fine. We'll play the second message for you.
Sorry that I got cut off. My great was Kate taking control of her happiness. And the flash forwards, it just really showed her being truly happy. And she deserves that. We've really seen her character heal and develop. I had a hard time seeing with her and Philip at the beginning, but now I'm just so happy because she seems so incredibly happy. And I think, you know, Kate and Toby found each other when they were both broken. They were broken people in their lives, and during their relationship, they healed and grew, and unfortunately, they just grew apart and it didn't work out, and sometimes that happens. And I have to say, Mary, you were right last week about Kevin and Madison, because it showed Madison with, I think his name's Elijah, and pregnant. So we know for sure that those two are done. So I wasn't really emotional for this episode because I've been through a divorce twice, unfortunately. And so I'm kind of numb to it, but I definitely had empathy for everything that they were going through. And, you know, Kate and Philip, I think their bond is over the tragedies that they had both experienced. So, but thank you guys so much for this podcast. I really enjoy listening to you guys, and thank you, Blake, for being vulnerable and raw with us. And I really admire that. So have a good day, guys. Bye.
Well, thank you, Jody. I appreciate the kind words about that episode. It's my pleasure, oddly enough, to be raw and vulnerable with all of you, because this is us too, man. That's what we're here for. It's our lives as well. And for better or for worse, you're all part of it. And you all get a chance to listen to me wax on about it. So thank you very much. And Marvin, Jody called it out, man. Jody called it out.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't get emotional because she's been involved through divorce at least twice. Wow.
So
spot on again, Marvin. Spot on.
I don't know how to. Sorry. Yeah.
No, it's just it's a great tidbit, or it's a great assessment of how some people could react to certain things, and I think it's very intuitive of you, Mary. Very intuitive.
Oh, thank you.
Hi, Mary and Blake. It's Gloria from
Methuen.
Katoby, what an episode!
From Boston.
I'm giving this one 4.5 lemonades.
I had a lot of questions. I know This Is Us is known for having different timelines within the same episode, mm-hmm. but this one was a little crazy to me. My good was Philip taking Kate to karaoke and playing that song for their performance. Kind of perfect for post-divorce signing. My bad, I have two. First, it seemed like the writers were rushing this episode. So much happened in one that spans so many years. I would have liked to see those storylines play out. Oh, and two, Toby calling Kate on her wedding day. Really, Toby? It had to be that day.
Yeah.
And my great was seeing future Kate very much alive and well. Both of them still living a life with their kids. Very happy about that. Being a divorcee myself, it was wicked hard. It sucked. And my four kids definitely needed us apart to be happy. And Kevin going through all those women, a little sad, but it does still give me hope for Cassidy. Team Cassidy forever. That's it. Bye, guys.
That's right, Gloria. You and I, Team Cassidy. I'm in. Let's go. Let's go with Team Cassidy. That's why she's my cousin from Boston. That's why. She Gloria will always be your cousin from Boston. Just throwing that out there.
Hi, Miriam Blake. It's Brittany from Pennsylvania.
Hi, Brittany.
And Katoby is kaput.
Oh, there we go.
This episode was a doozy. And Penny, I know you're listening. You know I want to give this episode a big fat zero. But upon further reflection, I'm going to give it a 4.5.
Okay.
My good was This Is Us playing with the timeline, the nonlinear storytelling, seeing the breakdown of the marriage, seeing the rebuild of a friendship and new relationships, new beginnings was great. Plus, we got to see Rebecca sort of in the middle of from where she is now to where we know she'll be in the end and see that decline a little bit. Makeup was on point, but also she couldn't remember Philip's name, which honestly, Bex, is that his name? I don't know either. My bad, and why I want to give it a zero, is Kevin and Madison are officially off the table. I don't know why I thought otherwise, because if I ship it, it's doomed to fail. But I'm disappointed. I also did not appreciate, oh yeah, Madison's pregnant, blah, blah, blah. Oh, look, Sophie. No, I don't care about Sophie. I don't want Kevin to end up with a hashtag who are they. I just want Kevin to be with his kids in his cabin. Oh, I'm so upset. My great, though, was this episode made me feel beyond just Kevin and Madison. Everything. I was angry. I was happy. I was hopeful. They did a great job.
All right. Mary and Blake Media Commandment. Got to feel.
Mm-hmm. That's
how you know it's good. If you feel.
Yes.
Brittany's got all the feels.
Oh, yes.
Angry, happy, sad.
Yes.
Frisky.
Inside Out would be proud.
Anger is just sitting there burning flames on his forehead. Oh, Lewis Black. Yeah, Mary, let me ask you this. Mm. We've had two calls in a row where Gloria does not like the nonlinear storytelling. Brittany, big fan, like me.
Yep.
Where are you on that spectrum?
I feel like This Is Us is always nonlinear.
Yeah, just but like this one was...
This one was all over the place.
Especially nonlinear. This felt like a Christopher Nolan movie.
Oh. I liked it a lot.
Yeah, you liked it. So you're on the... You like the
it was
non-linear.
Like a little surprise each time. Ooh, which time am I now? Like, okay, so one of the things that I loved is when we start off, you know, with Kate coming out and marriage and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Madison shuts the door. You know, oh, your brother's so funny or your brother's so weird or whatever. And as she shuts the door, you see the big old rock on her finger.
Right.
So, you know, it was this whole speculation about like who has wedding rings and who doesn't. So I love that we got that shot. And then, of course, at the engagement party, she's pregnant.
Yeah, right.
So, you know, little things like that and the different ages of the kids. And I don't know. I just had fun seeing those little things and getting surprises that weren't even the main characters. You know, I've watched it now two or three times. And when you get to rewatch it, you get to watch the extra people and pick up a little bit more on what they're saying and doing.
Part of me thinks they're going to go towards Sophie for Kevin. Because that woman lives in New York and she's flying out to LA for an engagement party. Like, that's like, that's a serious.
I think they got really close again.
I'm not saying that they didn't.
Yeah.
I'm just saying The fact is, she's like, you're flying out to LA. You're flying out 6 hours to go to an engagement party. I'm calling a little bit of shenanigans.
Well, maybe she needs a vacation.
Nevertheless, Marvin, I'm going to call shenanigans. Nevertheless, calling shenanigans.
Mm-hmm.
But we're still going to move on to the next voicemail. Let's do it.
Hi, guys. This is Paula. I wanted to talk about Kate and Toby from This Is Us. So I wanted to talk about the most controversial thing that Toby said that probably has had the internet raging, and that he is basically not Jack Pearson and he has been competing with Jack Pearson.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I do not think that was a low blow at all. I mean, was it not kind? Maybe, but, you know, sometimes unkind things need to be said. Truth hurts, Kate. But, like, really, if you stop to think about it, I don't think he's wrong. I mean, right before they got married, he's talking to Jack's ashes. Like, how much more competing with Jack Pearson can it get when you are talking to the urn of a man you never met? Second, just like everything that makes Kate happy, that made Kate happy in the early days of their relationship, had to do with a grand gesture, or if Toby wanted to fix something that Kate got upset about, he would do it with a grand gesture. Like the not bonding with Jack thing, didn't he make him a music room or something? And Kate was all mushy over it. Like, that's all it takes for Kate to be happy. And the second he stopped, well, producing stuff out of thin air and became, you know, himself, she didn't like him anymore. So I don't know, that made me very sad for him that he's competing with a dead man.
So,
and,
Mary,
you know, the second he stops,
Mary, is Toby right? Is he competing with Jack Pearson
in his own mind?
But no, but let's zoom out. Is he?
You mean to him, or is Kate comparing him?
Definitely to him. I know that he is. That's a guarantee. That's
yeah,
a
him himself. But, this is self-imposed.
But is he correct, though, that
no.
Kate is comparing him to Jack?
No, I think she's expecting him to be a good father.
But what is her definition of a good father? And is that informed by Jack Pearson? And could we thereby argue that he is, in fact, competing against Jack Pearson?
Okay, sure.
the resignation there just sounds great.
Am I competing against your mom?
No, but I never.
Like, it was never said until now that he was competing against Jack Pearson. So can I argue that I'm always competing against your mom?
No, because I've never framed it that way.
Neither has Kate.
I think that's a fair argument. I think that's a fair argument.
Thanks.
I don't mean it to sound like, you know, condescending. I'm agreeing with you, and as I'm agreeing with you, I'm thinking it through my head. I'm trying to find a hole in that argument, and I don't think I can. I think it's a fair argument.
Cool.
All right. Cool. All right. Let's get to the last.
It really helps sometimes that you have a dead parent as well when we need to relate to This Is Us. Gosh, friggin' This Is Us, man.
I know.
They just get you.
I know they get you
in the darkest ways.
And they bring in friggin' Whitney.
Oh, man.
All right. Let's get to the last voicemail, shall we?
Mm-hmm.
Hi, Mary and Blake. This is Abby from Maryland.
Hi, Abby.
And I could not resist calling in with a voicemail. About episode 612, Katoby.
Okay.
I don't have a GBG. I just wanted to give all the kudos to the writers for presenting co-parenting the way they did and in such a positive way. My ex-husband and I separated when our son was 2 months old. He's almost 7 now. And I ugly cried through this whole episode.
Yeah.
When baby Jack and grown-up Jack, you know, gave those bookends of you're both here, it got me in all the feels because divorce is hard and awful. And it's easier sometimes to focus on your adult problems and to be petty towards your ex. But all of our kids want, all that our kids want is to have both of their parents. And I mean, my son said the same thing around, you know, the age of 3 when I would pick him up from his dad and he would cry because he was so happy to be back with me. But he wanted to be able to be with both of us. And so I'm thankful to the writers for portraying two people who went through a divorce and felt all of that pain and hurt and hard feelings towards each other, but still prioritize showing up for their kids. This whole episode was incredible, but this aspect really stood out for me.
So there you go. There's an example of someone who having gone through divorce, having all of the feels.
And having gone through it with younger kids in mind.
Right, yeah.
I think, you know, I was just thinking, I was like, oh my gosh, like, I did not want my parents together. But I'm saying that as someone whose parents got divorced as I was a teenager.
Right. So you saw the ugliness
mm-hmm.
for what it was.
Yes.
Yeah.
Whereas, had you asked me that in elementary school, I would have wanted both my parents.
Gotcha. Together. So do you think there is a difference in that? This is kind of diving deeper a little bit here, getting a little bit more granular with the concept. Do you think there's a demarcation line for people who experienced divorce as a child, as opposed to someone who experienced divorce as an adult, like getting divorced themselves in terms of how they reacted to this episode?
I don't know. That's a really good question.
Oh, would you say that's a fair argument, Mary?
I think it depends upon how your parents just were. Went
right by you. Oh, gee, look, there goes the point.
I think it depends upon how your parents ended up years later.
Yeah.
I think there's some couples where one person never recovers. Sure. And they're bitter and like ruined forever. But the majority that I know of, after time, do find rays of sunshine elsewhere.
I would just say that if we got divorced, I would be the bitter, ruined forever person. Like I don't even like the word in the house. And that Mary will say that. Like she will attest to that. I don't even like that word in the house at all. So it's hard for me to even acknowledge that. But it's true. Like if that happened, I would be the bitter, my life is ruined, leave me in a dark hobbit hole for the rest of my life kind of person.
Yikes, man.
I would. Totally. just pure misery.
Bringing on the dark.
I know. All right, Marvin, that is it. That is it for all the voicemails. And we are now at an hour 12 mm-hmm. for this episode. So I think we've explored it pretty thoroughly. I'm sure that there are other things that did happen. I mean, you know, one last thing I will say, and I wrote this down, is why does Jack associate the big green egg so much with the day that his parents, like, marriage dissolved?
Oh my gosh. You want to know?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Jack is blind. And so his other senses are super strong.
Yeah.
And he probably smelled the green egg all day.
Making the meat. Gotcha.
And Toby's there saying, do you smell that? Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
So he has a very strong smell memory that associates with that day. You know, like when you smell things, you're like, this smells like Christmas.
Yeah. But I guess my question is, wouldn't like...
Adult Jack at that point, well established in his career, is far out from you're both here, piano adult Jack. I mean, he's living in like mansion,
yeah,
touring. So he knows that his parents were better, that things were okay. His parents both remarried and happily support him and mm-hmm. co-parent together. And so, like, I can look back and say, I'm glad my parents got divorced. They are happier now,
yes,
than they were.
Yes.
So that's how I take Jack in his memory of the green egg. That, mm-hmm. yeah, it was tough, but it ended up being okay.
Yeah.
And all now right. I get my parents happy. So.
Yeah, no, that makes sense.
But I think it's a smell memory.
Yeah, I guess I just wonder why he associates that with the dissolution of his parents' marriage. Like, wouldn't that be something else later on?
I think that's also like childhood putting it on themselves.
I wonder if he kind of, blames himself. Yeah. Yeah. Like, as you just said, like, if he blames himself like that, when he got his head screwed up, when he took off, that was the beginning of the end.
Yeah.
Because it was on him that things got messed up.
Yes. Like, okay, I will frequently say, oh, my being a teenager and going through the typical teenager pushback, I want to challenge the rules that my parents make, that might have been a catalyst. That mm-hmm. that was, in our relationship, that was a frequent division point between my parents. One would take my side and one wouldn't. Mm-hmm. And so for a while, I thought, I'm causing this.
Yep.
And I can look back, and that is how I remember the significant deterioration of my parents' marriage is my high school years over things about me. Because think about it. Jack might have like a slight memory of that day.
Sure.
And it's ingrained in his mind. And he only saw it from his perspective. He didn't see them fighting when he was asleep or not there. Right, so you only remember.
Yeah, he wouldn't have gotten the I'm competing against Jack Pearson thing. He wouldn't.
He remembers probably the chaos of the party and the house falling apart and him running away and like all the repercussions that were from that and probably had like this childhood guilt for a little while. Yeah. So.
No, fair enough.
He's messed up like all of us, guys. Jack went to therapy like all of us.
Lastly,
okay.
Kate obviously is alive and well in the her timeline. Which solves that mystery for all of us. We have not seen her in that timeline yet at all. This was the first time that we've seen her.
That's still not the same timeline.
Yeah, it is.
When?
In the her timeline?
In the dying Rebecca timeline?
Yeah.
We see Kate?
Yeah.
Where?
When she goes to the bar to go see Jack play.
See, but I think that's earlier. Jack isn't famous at that point. So if we're talking the same timeline. I don't know how old Jack is when Rebecca's dying. We haven't seen what age Jack is when Rebecca's dead.
Yeah, I think we can assume.
Or dying.
Yeah, like how far in advance is the her timeline from Jack playing at the bar, mm-hmm. right? Like, is it the same time?
Because we've seen Kevin's kid, right?
We've seen Kevin's son.
And he was...
He's like nine-ish.
Okay. So he's the same age as Haley. And Jack is maybe, what, 2-3 years older than Haley?
Yeah.
So Jack needs to be a young teenager in Rebecca's death timeline. But that doesn't make sense because they look so much older.
Right.
I mean, divorce does that to you.
It ages you. Ages you real quick.
It does.
But nevertheless, we see an older Kate.
The actor who plays Jack adult is just going to come in with like backwards hat,
no.
baseball cap.
Like Steve Buscemi. Hey, fellow kids.
Yeah.
You know, like. Oh, man. All right. So that is that. I think we should close this bad boy out. What do you think?
Yeah.
All right. Let's do it.
Thank you so much for those of you who are listening in live time. As you know, we've had
all the things.
Travel, my continued sickness, and life.
Vacation. Vacation was good. It was well needed.
I just napped a lot.
Yeah, you did.
That's why I was alive. But thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you especially to our friends at jointhenerdclan.com. If you're not yet a member there, and if we're a little lighthouse for you on your commutes or while you're cooking or at the gym, please think about joining. It's for as little as $2 a month. It goes to this mom and pop shop podcast that Blake and I run. So once again, it's just jointhenerdclan.com.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much. That's it. That's all we got.
My name's Mary.
My name is Blake.
And this is Us Too.